Michael, are you ready to go?
I'm ready. Thank you.
Okay, go ahead, sir.
So there are many definitions of world peace, but I consider world peace as a state in which all nations become willing to solve all conflicts peacefully. However, how do we achieve this goal? While it seems counterintuitive, the way to achieve world peace is through conflicts themselves. Humanity has to use issues and problems to achieve the necessary resolve and motivation to work together. The past can serve as examples to show how nations should work as a whole. Mutual issues can help bring nations together, and productive conflicts can allow humanity to progress together and improve relationships. Currently, the main reason why humanity is struggling to create peace is that we are not using peaceful solutions to solve conflicts. The idea is that using violent and aggressive methods will force others into submission, but violence and hatred do not result in peace. As an example, after World War I, the Treaty of Versailles was a harsh punishment against Germany. Using hostility to end World War I by severely punishing the Germans was one of the catalysts that caused World War II. It did not solve any conflicts or send a message to the world. The Treaty of Versailles caused a second, even more terrible global conflict. So what is the best solution to resolve disputes? Well, the answer comes by looking in the past again. Gandhi and Martin Luther King Jr. were peaceful protesters that became cemented in history for their efforts. Their methods inspired millions more to protest peacefully and show the world that love and peace are valid methods in solving disputes. People need to use the past to find examples of the best solution to solve current conflicts. The second way conflicts can help achieve world peace is with mutual disputes, meaning both sides are interested in solving the same problem. Currently, one of the most well-known mutual conflicts is global warming. The issue with solving the conflict of global warming is that each side is too busy blaming the other for their contribution to climate change or their lack of contribution to solving climate change. However, there is still some good news, as we have all at least recognized that global warming is a global threat that we need to resolve, and we must continue on this path. If the nations can work together and contribute to solving this crisis, it will be a milestone towards achieving world peace. It will serve as an example to show how that nations can work together to solve conflicts. We need to take away our political views in favor of recognizing mutual destruction. We need to realize that humanity is more important than a single country's interest. Finally, productive conflicts are an open exchange of ideas in which each party feels equally respected and involved. No party is afraid to voice their concerns and can reach a mutually comfortable solution. This type of conflict is our end goal. If we can achieve a world in which all international disputes become productive conflicts, we can confidently say that we have achieved world peace. During the Cold War, the Cuban Missile Crisis nearly ended up in a nuclear war. However, it didn't, because both countries believed in mutually assured destruction. Thus, they were able to come to an agreement and find a suitable solution. The first step in creating a productive conflict is by finding common ground. The next steps are making sure each side feels included and respected, and finally creating a mutually beneficial solution. We need to turn all international conflicts into productive conflicts, since in humanity's futures, there will always be some conflict to solve. Having a world where no conflicts exist is not possible, but we can achieve a world where all problems are solved peacefully. We need to use peaceful solutions, find mutual interests, and have productive conflicts as emerging strategies to resolve current and future disputes. Let us remember the tragedy of war and learn from past conflicts as examples of how we should solve disputes. Let us identify mutual conflicts to find nations' common interests and to work together as a whole. And let us turn conflicts into productive conflicts to allow each nation to be recognized and involved in determining resolutions. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. That was wonderful and very passionate as well. Now, your first question will come from Ms. Kelly. Kelly, go ahead, please.
Thank you, Michael. It was a great essay that I read. I enjoyed how you brought in some science aspects into your writing, so thank you. I wanted to ask you about, I agree with your framework in having two countries to work together, but as history has taught us, sometimes the need for power causes conflict. And so using your framework of countries working together, how would this initiative work for countries that are just looking to gain more power and control?
Yeah, so again, one of the major contributions to like war is greed. Obviously, some countries want to get more resources. They want to keep growing and growing and growing. And unfortunately, with these types of countries, it is really difficult to come to an appropriate resolution, because how can you find an appropriate solution if nothing's enough, how can you find a solution? So at that point, the basic way is to always try to find some way to make sure that country, to find that, like, change their ideology, change their idea, like try to stop them from looking for more power, try to find ways to get the country in order to get the idea that they don't need everything, and that each country, like, they can all coexist together. Now, yeah, there are some power hungry countries, but at the same time, I don't feel like they were always going to stay power hungry. At one point, there's going to be enough. One point, you're going to have to find a solution that can help each country feel respected. As long as they feel respected and they feel involved, I feel like all countries can find a way to create peace.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kelly, for your question. Now, I'm not going to be asking you to list who's the power hungry countries. No, we won't do that. So your second question will come from Mr. Colin from Brock. Colin, go ahead, please.
Yeah, so thank you, Michael. I really liked how, you know, you're talking about the importance of countries coming together to find mutually beneficial solutions. You talked about that mutually beneficial approach several times. But you know, sometimes there are conflicts where there is not a mutually beneficial outcome. So what do you do in those circumstances? How do you achieve peace when there's not a mutually beneficial outcome?
I think with those types of solutions, the best way to help keep all the sides happy is by having some kind of future compensation. I guess we can use global warming as an example. Right now, you can say with China, the reason why they're not really happy with having to shift to all renewable energy is because they're still developing. They are not, like, unlike US, unlike all these other countries, they're not developed yet. So it feels kind of like hypocritical to say, no, you're not allowed to develop because you're contributing to climate change. But that's the same way we got to our developed state. So in order to help, like, you have to have some kind of compensation, something like, okay, we will give you some more resources, or we will help you get along with this, or like find some kind of way to basically give a motive to help them bring to a mutually assured mutual solution. Because yes, it's true, there's sometimes you can't reach a solution where everyone is happy, but you can reach a way that you can compensate for the countries that are not happy for it.
Great. Thank you.
Thank you, Colin. And thank you, Michael. That was wonderful.